Welcome to an introduction to Thierry C, Pauchant and Associates anthology, In Search of Meaning, Managing for the Health of Our Organizations, Our Communities, and the Natural World from 1995. In the book, an esteemed list of authors and professionals within management theory, psychology, policy, strategy, and sociology takes a look at organizational life from an existentialist perspective. This is a bold movement in many ways. For one, understanding how organizations function is in itself an enormous task. Organizations can be viewed through an infinite amount of lenses, and the more we begin to understand, the more questions arise. Secondly, existential themes are no easier to wrap one's mind around. They offer few answers and are both elusive in nature and very real. Moreover, the two schools of thought seem to be concerned with completely different issues, existentialism looking within and organizational theory looking without. How can one combine these two focal points, and why? Well, to be sure, it does require an open mind, a certain spark, and patience. When one uses the existential lenses on organizational matters, one does not so much attain a certain knowledge as much as a certain way when approaching others and when confronting oneself. The existential psychotherapist Irvin Yalom has suggested that our existence ultimately revolves around four ultimate concerns that man must confront throughout life: death, our freedom to choose, our fundamental loneliness, and our search for meaning. When we regard organizations as creations stemming from these existential concerns, organizational meaning and rationalism takes on new forms. From this perspective, organizations are no longer simply something out there. Organizations are also deeply interrelated to the choices we make, the creative work we accomplish, and our relations with other people. When organizations are regarded from an existential perspective, solutions of a far stronger caliber becomes available because we are able to ground our understanding in concerns shared by all human beings, including our own most fundamental concerns. This provides us with far better footing, far better reasoning, and far more meaning. With those words, let's dive into In Search of Meaning, which is divided into four parts. Part one deals with our challenge of finding meaning in work and workaholism. Part two deals with the excellence ideal, the relationship between authorities and subordinates, and organizations as existential creations. Part three deals with our need for illusions, human relations and active listening, the dark side of organizations, and the fundamental questions of life from a work perspective. Part four offers two examples of the existential perspective from the religious realm and the business domain. And in the last chapter, the various approaches are combined to suggest a number of ways to proceed on an existential-minded path. With those words, let's look at part one, the challenge of finding meaning in work. What is economic effectiveness? We often talk about it, but we rarely define it. The notion of economic effectiveness has a central position in management and organizational research, whereas meaning receives little attention. Effectiveness, however, is more than mindless production. Rather, it is a major concern for the human being. Some even claim that existence consists only and exclusively in making to exist, that existence is absolutely nothing beyond this function or power. From an organizational and individual point of view, this emphasizes the ethical dimension. What image of ourselves do we intend to leave as a social organization? Another aspect of organizational effectiveness is its infatuation with perfection or the excellence ideal. Individuals willingly commit to this ideal because perfection is something that the human being regards as an ideal to be pursued. We fail in the best of intentions, however, and over again must man realize that he is a limited, finite, and imperfect mortal being. Perfection is a coincidence of many parameters, most of which we do not control. And when perfection is considered the one and only goal, man is set on an existential quest that can never be successful. Modern culture is also obsessed with self-accomplishment. For the human being, however, the need for transcendence and self-accomplishment is not an objective in itself. Rather, it is a consequence of this necessity to surpass oneself. In other words, transcendence occurs only in relation to others, and when we accomplish something that forces us to step out of our inner boundaries, distance ourselves from egocentric interest, and concentrate our efforts on an authentic mode of existence with others in the world. To negotiate this reality, managers must establish meaningful objectives and reprioritize the expressive functions of work by encouraging and rewarding creativity, service, and personal commitment. Once again, individuals must be able to ascribe meaning to their actions, relationships, and lives in order to preserve their mental health. They need to commit themselves to a cause that they deem valuable in a manner they deem valuable. In short, work must be considered not only as a production factor, but as an instrument of individual and social development. From here, let's look at workaholic behavior as a way to avoid existential anxiety. Organizational existentialism holds that workaholic behavior is a means of avoiding the basic existential issues of being human. An existential addiction supplants all other aspects of life and becomes the sole justification for being. For the workaholic, work is life. Increasingly, the corporation is emerging as the major solution for individuals who develop existential addictions. Through work, we can develop and nurture an addiction to reduce self-awareness and life's fundamental unpredictability. The lifestyle induced by permanent action is in a sense comparable to that of drugs and generates a form of deplorable but highly addictive dependency. People are now used to this acceleration and hectic activity. They complain about it, but whenever it stops, they wonder what's going on. In fact, it seems as though one part of man may be totally committed, rationally and emotionally, to the necessity of permanent action and progress, while the other part has the feeling of no longer being in control and is afraid of succumbing to its deadly momentum. To address the problem, the acceptance and outright admiration of workaholism must be re-evaluated and more emphasis made of the dangers of workaholism. What must emerge instead is the awareness that living a superficial and inauthentic life is inevitably stressful and that recovery can only occur if we as individuals confront life honestly and authentic. From here, let's go to part two, resisting the myth of organizational perfection, the search for excellence and the denial of death. In most modern management literature and in everyday management, excellence is suggested or requested. Since its inception in 1982 with Tom Peters and Robert Waterman's The Search for Excellence, the excellence trend has taken the world by storm and evolved into many management trends. Total quality, just in time, constant innovation, time-based management, etc. The excellent trend is obsessed with planning and controlling and, in essence, claims that man through work is offered a chance to transcend death. In short, by offering meaning and money, excellent companies give their employees a mission, a chance to become a pioneer and feeling part of something great. Individuals willingly surrender themselves to this illusion if the organizational purpose provides them with a sense of greater meaning that also allows them to stand out and satisfy their own ambitions. From a business perspective, the excellent trend proposes that the world can be reduced to a world consisting primarily of organizations. According to this image, individuals are objects of a larger and impersonal system. The image also implies that the wish of individuals to actualize themselves must be fulfilled by their association with a corporation. Moreover, It turns the organization into a symbol of immortality to be defended at all costs. If the individual cannot survive, the organization will. The Pulitzer Prize-winning author Ernest Becker recognized the necessity and usefulness of illusions, but also warned that there is nothing wrong with an illusion that is creative, up to a point, of course, the point at which the illusion lies about something very important, such as human nature. This, however, is exactly what happens intellectually when organizations are elevated over man and man is assigned the role as a tool for a higher objective. The organization may be part of the answer, but if we make it the answer, we risk losing our humanity. Existentialism is adamant that individuals cannot triumph over death physically or mentally, and that we must confront this reality at however high cost it may come, because if not, our fear of death will also materialize as a fear of life. And out of this fear, we may willingly blind ourselves to life's realities and escape into any leader or idea that can take away the responsibility for choosing. And a leader that offers to take away our worries will always show up. On an individual level, the excellent trend holds that being the best is the absolute necessity of our times, and that excellence is simply another word for self-accomplishment, the only remaining finality. The individual is the entrepreneur of his own life, and his quest for success and accomplishment justifies whatever efforts are needed to give a meaning to existence. Despite this infatuation with personal self-accomplishment, the excellent trend holds that management is responsible for defining an organization's core values and vision. Contrary to this, Ernest Becker and the existential tradition argues that the search for meaning is a personal experience beginning from childhood. Individuals must come to feel and believe from their own life experiences that what they are doing is truly meaningful. Now, let's look at the relationship between employees and leaders and the questions of authority and obedience. The management of excellence, deified executives and depersonalized employees. A substantial part of contemporary managerial literature is based on the notion that humankind is blessed with a few exceptional individuals who are the incarnation of the entrepreneurial phenomenon. This literature is practically a cult of the exceptional individual, the hero, the creator and builder of organizations of all ilks. Once merely business school stars, but now global media stars. This admiration of the leader is a powerful potion that managers on all levels endow themselves with because the entrepreneurial spirit has embedded in it a sense of immortality. The divination of management also brings with it the understanding of employees as mere mortal human beings that must stand guard for the divine leaders and surrender themselves to be managed as passive, obedient, and interchangeable objects. The result may be systems of obedient participants that care and dare not question agreed truth or errors leading to cultures in high risk of disasters despite ample resources and knowledge. These organizations often exhibit a focus on power, control, and an anal behavior that effectively delimits individual honesty and authenticity. Yet, this is exactly what is required for any organization to be innovative, adaptive, and sustainable. To escape the trap, managers must agree to step down, symbolically and materially, from the pedestals as super people who manage others. Instead, they must try to embody the hero according to Greek mythology, that is, accept in full lucidity the idea of one's death and demonstrate one's status by performing truly heroic acts. From here, let's look at organizations as existential creations, restoring personal meaning while staying competitive. According to existentialism, man is nothing but what he makes of himself. Or in the words of Sartre, man is the creature whose project is to be God. This sets the individual as his own subject and the defining point of his universe. With the death of God, the organization and professional work has emerged as the universal project man can focus his energy into to realize himself. As such, the organization makes up for the current lack of meaning by providing individuals with a framework and an instrument to define the meaning of their life. In reality, one's professional career has become the central organizing element and the source of meaning in life. Moreover, incessant work and material success is regarded as both means and evidence of personal salvation in the next world. This makes the approach all the more powerful because professional success then becomes a moral as well as an economic necessity. But it also demands that one must not merely work for the organization, one must be the organization and see the organization as the arbiter of personal destiny, as an object of love, and as the only source of self-accomplishment. The modern result is managerial man that sees the organization as a way of satisfying an inner requirement beyond him. This makes success the only acceptable form of existential accomplishment, the only solution to existential anxiety, and the only justification for the considerable efforts that are demanded within the organization. Managerial man is doomed to success. This system is efficient as long as the individual and the organization operate in tandem, but to avoid losing himself, the individual must learn to keep his distance and avoid transforming his self-commitment into enslavement. From here, let's turn to part 3, Rediscovering Responsibility and Courage in Organizations. A Private Journey, Uniting the Fragmentary Self Through Contradiction, Conversations Between Douglas and Galen. The chapter explores various aspects of existential issues in a corporate context through a number of conversations between Douglas and Galen. The first story, Living in the Midst of Paradox, explores how we need illusions because they offer us a shared way to cope with the anxieties from the reality of existence. However, one must always be aware that illusions are just that, illusions, and merely a coping mechanism that must not take over the person and rule life completely. To illustrate this, Galen tells the story of Frederick that borrowed illusion after illusion only to realize the shortcomings of each and all of them. Frederick did bodybuilding exercising, assuming that if he was strong, he would no longer feel weak. However, the stronger he got, the weaker he felt, for now he understood the actual limits of his strength. He went to sensitivity school to learn how to empathize with others' feelings. He empathized so fully that he was always overwhelmingly sad. Finally, he resolved to live a life based only on the truth as he understood it. No longer would he accept as real what society deemed as true. This solution, however, created a new illusion that he never realized. He started to believe that human existence could be lived in isolation, but the result was that henceforth he felt the daily pain not only of being unconnected to others, but also of having no shared way to deal with any of the pain that his own existence invented. Frederick willed himself free, but this excessive willing actually willed himself unfree. Illusions are a useful concept, but if they take over existence completely, they motivate a focus solely on what it is becoming and nullifies any desire to simply be in the present. In Changing by Preserving the Status Quo, Douglas and Galen ponders the intertwinedness of change and stasis. The basic premise is that change and stasis does not have to be considered opposites. Rather, they co-define each other. If everything is changing, then nothing is changing. In recent years, most organizations have changed so often that nowadays the greatest change in our organizations would occur if they were not to change. In fact, it seems we are addicted to change and bounce ourselves into the next change even before the previous change has settled. The result is organizations that are always structurally unstable. The point of the story is that resistance in itself is not negative. Rather, it is a sign that there are forces to be mobilized. Therefore, one should start with the question, What am I attempting to preserve by this change? If one begins this way, many of those who feel they are for the status quo will see that you are too, and that you are invested both in the change part of the process, but also in the stasis. Beyond the Binary Mind sums up the conversations with Douglas, concluding that he used to believe that one can be excellent or mediocre and strive to be the best, that he believed one could be good or bad and strive to be noble. The conversations with Galen, however, has made him realize that this either-or diminished both him as a person and those around him. Douglas concludes, "What has changed for me is that I am now seeing my experience in both-and terms. I'm neither excellent nor mediocre. I'm both excellent and mediocre. I am neither good nor bad. I am both good and bad. I am neither positive nor negative. I am both positive and negative." For a long time, management thought has been captured by the rationalistic, the digital brain, and either-or terminology. As a result, we have overlooked the wisdom contained in our analogic brain and the world of both-and. How we think can fragment our experience of the world, leaving us to integrate what we have artificially divided. But we can adopt a more holistic perspective if we question our everyday logic of rationalism and learn to see the both and contained in every either or. If one part is black, there is always a white part we should learn to look for. Now, let's look at relationships. Carl Rogers meets Otto Rank. When someone really hears you, without passing judgment on you, without trying to take responsibility for you, without trying to mold you, it feels damn good. Inspired by Otto Rank, the heart of Carl Rogers' teachings is that actively listening to another is to facilitate the psychological growth of a person in the never-completed process of becoming a fully functioning human being, of accepting and being oneself the creator and author of one's own life, both inward and outward. "I can state the overall hypothesis in one sentence," says Carl Rogers. "If I can provide a certain type of relationship, the other person will discover within himself the capacity to use that relationship for growth, and change in personal development will occur. For a person's creative potential to be released," Rogers found, "it is not the helper's authority, knowledge, technique, or interpretations that matter. It is the relationship itself that cures. Only by willing to be oneself within a relationship, by accepting one's own difference and having it accepted by another, can one discover the creativity and strength to change. In other words, what matters is not therapeutical training or corporate lingo, but communicating that the client, partner, and employee is accepted and affirmed without judgment or evaluation in becoming and being a person entirely different from all other people." From a managerial perspective, this suggests that the manager must be congruent, fully present in the here and now, with no pretense of emotional distance, no professional facade. The approach demands a wholesome self-assertiveness of the manager's own creative will, his own individuality and difference. It also holds that there is no single reality, but only different interpretations and perspectives. Fully accepting the employee's frame of reference, therefore, requires that the manager helper must express genuine empathic understanding for the employee, entering the private perceptual world of the other and becoming thoroughly at home in it without making judgments. No mortal can always live up to this. Rather, the process consists of moving farther and farther along the continuum, getting better and better at being or performing these conditions. Like living itself, managing people is a performing art that is not attained once and for all, but must be created anew and ever anew. From birth, man's existence is marked by guilt. Guilt is a consequence of consciousness and originates out of the sheer difference between us and others. The neurotic refuses the lone life in order to escape the pain, death, from which he seeks to buy himself free by daily partial self-destruction. Conversely, The creative man, the artist, philosopher, or scientist can react in a constructive way and affirm himself as a human being. Regardless of spirit, the project is doomed, though. At the end, death awaits all alike, hero or coward, consumed by guilt or will. The more strongly man feels his freedom and independence, the more intense, on the other hand, is the consciousness of guilt, which appears in the individual partly restrictive, partly creative. It does not seem possible to eradicate these two ultimate anxieties, which appear to be an existential burden carried out of the womb by every new arrival on the planet. Sometimes it is fear of life, the fear of becoming and being oneself, separate and different from everyone else, that has the upper hand. At other times, it is fear of death, the fear of merging into the other, into the collective, and losing one's individuality that predominates. The eternal conflict between the wish for and fear of separation and the wish for and fear of union has no final solution. It can only be a matter of balance between the two, which is not attained once and for all, but must be created anew and ever anew. Although the tension between guilt and creativity can never be overcome, it can be made more bearable in a relationship with another person who accepts one's uniqueness and difference and allows for the emergence of the creative impulse. The Austrian philosopher Martin Buber phrased it eloquently. A great relationship breaches the barriers of a lofty solitude, subdues its strict law, and throws a bridge from self-being to self-being across the abyss of dread of the universe. After considering the benefits and importance of active listening, let's look at the dark side of organizational life. We may think of the dark side of organization as that part of culture that is experienced by the participants as something that should not be part of the culture, as the shameful side. It is the part of life that is not acknowledged and that individuals attempt to bar from their conscious awareness. Organizations have a dark side too. This is seldom talked about, although we all experience it. If we are to understand and work with organizations, however, it is not enough to confine ourselves to the light side, because the light side cannot be understood without reference to the dark side. The light side, or the ego ideal, is vividly illustrated in the glass ceiling imagery. A state of perfection that a person believes she can see, but that, despite no visible barriers, it is not possible to get to. Within this organization ideal, individuals correspond perfectly to their organizational roles. They do their jobs spontaneously and out of desire, and the organization is in perfect concordance with its external environment. Like any ideal, the organizational ideal never materializes. Yet it nurtures in us a longing for a mental state of mind where we are the center of a loving world in some sort of womb-like bliss. This craving for an ideal state in turn causes the participants to question their own acceptability and lovability, because they realize their own shortcomings and that they may not belong in the organization ideal. But if not perfection, what then is the meaning of organizational life? When one looks at people in organizational lives in terms of the underlying meaning, one thing that stands out very clearly is the desire for promotion, for rising in the hierarchy. In fact, rising in the hierarchy is practically a moral imperative, and many will sacrifice almost anything for it: family, attachment to places, work that they love, etc. But promotion never lives up to our fantasy about it. We think that we will no longer be subject to forces that are outside our control and that we would instead be the force that control others. As it turns out, we are still subject to forces outside our control, they're just bigger. And further, our control over others is often only nominal and deeply problematic. This, again, must be solved by further promotion. In this way, the horizon always stands before us and beckons us toward it. The capacity to accept human reality for what it is, in oneself as well as in others, makes for the possibility of an identification with others that is far more real and therefore more profound than that of mutual idealization of the ego ideal, because we have a far more diverse and accurate set of prisms to guide us. The argument here is that suppression of the dark side leads to a loss of intellectual leverage and a loss of personal, organizational, and even social vitality. This suggests that bringing light to the dark side, painful though it may be, is likely to be less painful and more productive in the long run than leaving it in the dark. From here, let's look at the four questions of life. Why me? Whom do I turn to? What should I do? And who am I? Man cannot accept meaninglessness. When something bad happens, man will look for a reason. It is not important whether the reason he succumbs to is correct. As long as there is some kind of existential explanation, what happened to him is no longer meaningless, and therefore he is no longer meaningless. At the same time, the explanation must be congruent with already established truth. If, for instance, primitive man was offered a scientific explanation for why his hut blew down, he would not, could not accept it, since it would require a completely different compartmentalized explanation and run counter to his human need for unified explanation. In other words, for any explanation to be acceptable, it must live up to some generally agreed upon principles. In modern times, scientific and rationally based explanations is the foundation that ties our world together. This trust in scientific rationalism is recognized in another of life's fundamental questions: whom do I turn to? In modern times, the overarching answer is technology. More than anything, modern organization is characterized by technology and a conviction we can rise to humanity through technology. More technology, however, only means more depersonalization, more bureaucracy, more laws, and more professional careers where simple compassion is absolved for professional rules. So to answer the question, to whom do I turn? Man, other people, not systems. To have meaning is to receive attention from a being capable of self-awareness. When we turn to abstract systems, we risk losing the only thing that is not abstract, our humanity. This leads to life's third question: what should I do? The standard answer of most organizations is, you should do it our way. The Eastern ego will tend to accept this organizational answer, whereas the Western capital I egos will demand rational proof. The individual sings out, I'll do it my way, while management counters, you must be a team player. Such inconsistent social messages place employees in a double bind and reinforce a split mind unless managers recognize the existential need for team play and leave room for, I'll do it my way. The fourth question of life is as simple as it is puzzling. Who am I? From birth, man oscillates between the desire and need for individual justice versus the harmony of the commons. The mystery systems of the West have often overgeneralized the adversarial goal of individual justice at the expense of harmony. For the Greeks, for instance, the goal of the individual ego was to be able to say, I am first. In the Olympic Games of ancient Greece, there were no prizes for second place. Consequently, in the West, freedom meant the opportunity to think, study, argue for one's opinion, and seek justice, not oblivion, loss of desire, or escape from pain, as it did in the East. So, to answer, who am I? Don't answer that the individual ego is unimportant. Answer that the individual ego is unique and needs opportunity to grow to be more effective and happy in ambiguous situations. Adversary relationships and anxiety are reduced in those who develop unique expertise and know who they are, in and out of the organization. Now, let's turn to the final part four, two stories of the search for meaning in organizations. Life in a spiritual community, organizational culture, and its discontent. The Sisterhood of Our Lady of the Good Shepherd and the Fallen Girls Home illustrates how fictitious constructions limit the understanding of differences and similarities among people. The Fallen Girls Home is an institution where so-called fallen girls live under the supervision of what are referred to as the Brides of Christ, based on an ancient mystic system. The tale raises the argument that even though discontent in organizational culture cannot be totally eliminated, we must recognize that organizational reality is often much more complex than predominant theories of management and organization make it out to be. In addition to structuring and controlling production and economic processes, organizations are spaces in which often high numbers of people, both individually and collectively, spend their entire working lives as a constituent part of their lives. These people perceive organizations as arenas or theaters in which people are acting out their dramas of life. As soon as we are prepared to give up the fictitious construction that work organizations serve primarily to provide income and produce goods, both our work and our lives have to be seen from another, much broader perspective. However, although meaning can be seen as the essence of human existence, the quest for meaning is not an easy venture. It includes becoming aware of the relatedness of our own inner world, our dreams, hope, and anxieties with the outside reality and its social construction. The second story in part four is Not From These Parts, a tale of organizational turmoil. Not From These Parts tells us tale of a healthy local bank that goes bankrupt in a matter of days because of rumors and innuendos spun out of hand. One of the morals of the tale is that often people will construct a simple scenario that can account for important known facts, whether or not this scenario in itself seems likely. The invented scenario, even if bad, may actually be wished for so that something, anything, will happen to break the monotony of everyday life. This will also justify the invented scenario and people's perception of their good general understanding of the world and their environment. But reality is far too complicated to be grasped in one single theory or thought. Hence, what can be called the plague in organizations are the very values and beliefs that guide human conduct as members of families, work organizations, and nations, because adherence to abstract principles implies a possible willingness, in the name of principle, to participate in the extinction of the one thing that is not abstract, our humaneness. In other words, any ideology carries within it seeds of the absurd because it represents a structure of values and beliefs designed to interpret experience and, by the same token, to divorce the interpreting human from experience. Thus, the symptoms of the plague lies not in the inappropriateness of a particular set of principles in the governance of individual lives, but in the very existence of unquestioned sets of principles. With those words, we've reached the final chapter and conclusion, the healthy organization, reuniting the self, the organization, and the natural world. For now, we do not know enough on the subject of existentialism in organizations to propose a generic and comprehensive program. Still, a list of 8 quick and dirty questions may be used to determine whether a managerial approach or methods seems to embrace existential ideals or not. Be aware, however, that this way of proceeding should not be substituted for a personal grounding in the existential tradition, and that the invention of such lists in itself runs counter to the existential message. Question 1. Does the approach address complex issues without trivializing them? This involves using straightforward language about existential issues and promoting a genuine dialogue between people. At the same time, to develop individual imagination, dreams, and fantasies rich enough to mobilize individuals into implementing actions, one must be wary of proposing lists and steps that managers should use to improve their thinking, since this in itself limits thinking. In short, existentialism is a demanding subject, and the task is to guide as subtle as possible to avoid indoctrination or determination. Question 2. Is the approach grounded in the individual in concrete relation with the world, avoiding an escape into either individualism or collectivism? Existentialism is not individualism. The individual is unique, yes, but the individual becomes an individual through encounters and actions with others. This dialectic dance between the self and others avoid the escape into so-called team spirit, family spirit, community spirit, and other holographic nonsense currently emphasized in many organizations and popular management books. Question 3. Does the approach encourage the development of an individual source of responsibility and values? Existentialism can reveal how routinization of problematic behaviors can serve as an escape from the courageous confronting of existential issues. Organizations do not exist independently of the individuals that compose them. The existentialist perspective grounds itself on this assertion and posits that the primary locus of meaning, values, and responsibilities is to be found in the existentially healthy individual. It is only secondarily derived from such abstract notions as liberty, community, equality, and efficiency. Question 4. Does the approach apprehend the individual and collective subjective realities of individuals in relation to their physiological health? Existentialists focus both on the well-being of individuals and that individuals should be critical of themselves and of their cultural heritage in order to find a sense of personal meaning and to protect the fragile physical health of both individuals and the ecology. The concrete realizations of one's fragility and death leads to a realization of both the pain and fragility of the lives of others and of the planet. Question 5. Are the approach's aims targeted towards an increase in humanistic health and meaning, but also compatible with an ecological perspective? The existentialist focus on the relationship between existential issues and physiology or ecology emphasizes the importance of the largest context in which individuals live and die. Human beings have a responsibility towards the larger world to live in harmony with the entire cosmos, of which human beings and society are only a part. Question 6. Are the approach's aims targeted toward an increase in humanistic health and meaning, but also grounded in the transpersonal realm? The existentialist tradition has emphasized the need for the sacred, for mythology, for spirituality, understood not as religious dogma, but as a more general way of transcending the concerns of individuals per se, of allowing active commitment. In this book, this need has been emphasized by proposing that one's motivation be grounded in one's mystery system while one remains critical. In the words of Abraham Maslow, "We need something bigger than we are to be awed by and to commit ourselves to in a new naturalistic, empirical, non-churchly sense." Question 7. Does the approach address both the bright and dark sides of life, focusing on issues such as success and prosperity, as well as on losses, despair, and death? Life is difficult, and so an authentic, responsible, and courageous individual need to address both the light side and dark sides of life. Unauthentic individuals are much less capable of or outright powerless in preventing crisis. This dialectical view of life differs from most approaches in current management. Question 8. Does the approach limit the existence of fundamental paradoxes and use a dialectical mode of reasoning? Existentialism embraces a dialectical perspective and emphasizes the necessary dance between life and death, humans and nature, material and spiritual, stability and change. An individual is not only to be determined by his or her past, but is also free to create a future. Similarly, a good solution always has a problematic side. This perspective challenges current theories. Quite simply, it is much more difficult to address anxiety-producing experiences than to deny them, no matter how disastrous the consequences. This lack of existential courage is perhaps the strongest reason why the existential tradition has not been wisely used in management to date. Moreover, the required dialectical dance is challenging since most of us prefer some variant of binary thinking in which good and bad really are good and bad. In this respect, fiction and other literary works can come to great use in education and lead to a less analytical, logical, and dispassionate analysis of problems. Classics such as Animal Farm by George Orwell, The Brothers Karamazov by Dostoevsky, or The Castle by Franz Kafka is guaranteed to offer the simplest and deepest introductions to existential concepts and, if read with an eye on their relationship to organizational issues, will surprise the reader in terms of their relevance to the daily and concrete practices of management. Moreover, these classics will encourage and stimulate discussion about big questions. In the words of Fritz Schumacher, conventional maps produced by modern materialistic scientism leave all the questions that really matter unanswered. More than that, they deny the validity of the questions. All of the above may help to explain why the existential tradition is not easy to summarize and why existential issues and authors are more like a wet bar of soap. It slips away every time we try to hold it firmly, yet it is very real in terms of the foam it leaves on the hand. Still, use of the existential tradition in management can be a goldmine for courageous individuals who wish to engage themselves in experimentation and research. And keep in mind that the purpose of organizational existentialism is not to create an additional independent school of management. Rather, existential concepts are relevant to many management domains. For instance, organizational behavior, culture and motivation, managerial decision-making, organizational change, crisis and effectiveness. But what the integration of existential issues in management is not is a luxury. Existential issues have direct implications for the mental, physical, social and economic health of human beings and for the health of the planet. Furthermore, they spring from the concrete suffering of individuals and have been acknowledged since the beginning of science some 2,500 years ago. While work today is regarded as merely a source of living, the existential promise is that work could be so much more. With those words, thank you for your attention. I hope with this introduction to have engaged the reader's imagination and warmly suggest to study In Search of Meaning by Thierry C. Pauchant and Associates further for more inspiration. If anything, the entire point of the existential tradition is to encourage personal reflection, and if the reader picks up In Search of Meaning or other relevant literature following this introduction, I can ask for nothing more. Also, feel free to visit my website for more presentations on organizational theory, existentialism, images of organizations, and the trust-based workplace. Again, thank you.